Well, thanks for being here as we continue on in our series called Unstuck. And I just want to be honest with you, something you probably already know. It's kind of a scary world out there. You know, there are always those of us who want to say, I remember the good old days when you could have your 10-year-old child, they could walk all through the neighborhood and come home, you know, even after it was dark, and you didn't have to worry about it. How many have ever said that or heard someone say that, right? I remember the good old days when it was safe. And nowadays, if you have a 10-year-old that walks more than 2 blocks, we bring the parents in and we interrogate the parents. What's wrong with you, you know, leaving these kids out? Don't you know what a scary world it is? And that's the reality. It is a different day. And we admit that they're scary times. Then also, I think there are other times when I think we just kind of like add fear to like everything we do anymore. For example, have you noticed that we're scared of food anymore? But somebody's like, I ain't scared of food. No, you know what I'm talking about? It's like, what can you really eat that's not going to kill you? Right? I mean, it used to be, it was all about cholesterol. Don't eat remember when everything was low fat? Stay away from the fat. Have you heard recently? Now they're like, you can have the fat. And some of God's people said, amen to that. So it used to be, oh, fats are evil. Now fats aren't evil. And then for a while, it's like, don't drink coffee. It's like, oh, you know, coffee has this benefit. And it's don't drink too much coffee. Have caffeine. What can you do? Remember drink milk? It's good for your bones. Used to always be drink lots of milk, you know, and now it's like, well, I don't know about milk, I'm not so sure, and it goes back and forth. And then, the all-time staple was fruits and vegetables. You could safely eat fruits and vegetables, but nowadays we're like, you know what, you really should eat organic fruits and vegetables. If you're going to eat them, you know, they don't have all this, you know, whatever. And how many remember when just chicken was good for you, right? I could eat chicken. Chicken's good. Nowadays, they're like, you know what? If you're going to eat chicken, you really should try to get antibiotic-free, cage-free, taste-free, you know, whatever it is, you know. And go ahead and get that chicken, folks. Believe me, it's anything but free when you buy it. And it's just like we're afraid of almost anything to eat. It turns out, frankly, we Americans are pretty good at being afraid of just about everything. In fact, there's a word for this irrational fear. It's called phobias. And one agency has compiled a list of 537 phobias, and they're coming at you, aren't they? And you know, many of the most famous ones you're familiar with. We're afraid of spiders, we're afraid of the dark, we're afraid of public speaking, we're afraid of heights, we're afraid of death. But there are hundreds of them, including things like some people are afraid of string, or the color yellow, or garlic, or the fear of sitting down, or the fear of flutes. I know that's very common, you know, it's just... And we laugh about some of this, but here's the problem with fear. It's really not a laughing matter. Fear surrounds us. It steals from us. It paralyzes us. It leaves us stuck. Stuck doing some things we feel compelled to do because we're afraid. Stuck not doing some things we really could do and should do because we're afraid. Fear is the most common, one of the most common tricks, methods that our enemy, the devil, uses. And truthfully, I wonder, what would a picture look like if we piled up all of the potential work of God and work for God that has never happened because we were too afraid? We would undoubtedly weep. And for some of us, it happens simply because we are stuck in fear. And this is why God tells us that we should not fear. Now, he doesn't say that we shouldn't feel afraid. We all have moments when we feel afraid. Something that can generate fear suddenly arrives, and we feel afraid for a moment. But Jesus' command to us is this: do not fear, meaning this, don't take into your life the air of fear. Don't live under the constant mindset of fear. Don't be consumed by fear. In other words, if a grizzly bear starts running at you, your heart is going to start pounding, but that doesn't mean you're disobeying God. That just means you're alive, at least for now. So when you think about getting unstuck from fear, we're talking about not letting fear rise to this exalted place in our life where it controls what we do and what we don't do. Today I want to look at how we can get unstuck from the cycle of fear in our lives, from fears that haunt us, fears that hold us back, fears that frankly will make us make poor decisions. And so to do so, I want to share with you a Bible story. It's about a woman named Esther, and you can find it in a book in the Bible that is titled Esther. Now, so I just want to share a story, and sometimes I share stories, I just want to kind of sit down to share it. And so I just want to kind of get you, help you understand where all this kind of begins from. But one little interesting tidbit that I want to give you as we get started is there is one word that is missing from the book of Esther that's a very common word that's found all throughout Scripture, but it's not there a single time. It's absent completely in the book of Esther. And the word is God. The word God doesn't show up in Esther once. Now, the work of God shows up a lot, but the word God doesn't. And actually, truth be told, I think that actually is kind of the beginning of our instruction today on fear. Because I think sometimes when we face fearful things, we are tempted to feel like, where's God? I don't feel him right now. I don't sense him right now. I'm not getting any direction from him. And so there are these things that can create fear in our lives, and it can cause us to wonder, where is God? And no doubt Esther felt that way. But I want to show you as we walk through this story how Esther dealt with that. Okay, so here's the story. You probably know that the people of God, after they were rescued by Moses and they came out of Egypt, they had this exodus out of Egypt, so that's where you find that story in the book of Exodus. They come out of Egypt and they go eventually, after years in the desert, they make it into the promised land and they conquer the promised land. But the problem is, over there, hundreds and hundreds of years in the promised land, they keep on going up and down, seesawing back and forth, obeying God, disobeying God, obeying God, and frankly, more often than not, disobeying God. So much so that when you get to the end of this era, past the judges into the kings, you get to where there's wicked king after wicked king after wicked king, and even the southern kingdom, which hung on a little longer with a few righteous kings, gets to where no one's honoring God, virtually no one. And so God says, well, I guess I'm going to have to discipline my people because I love them. And so he says, I'm going to give them a time out. In fact, I'm going to give them time out of the promised land. And so they go into what's called the exile. The Babylonians are the power of the day, and they come in and they wipe out God's people. And they take many of God's people, the finest, the brightest, they take them back into Babylon. Eventually, they're in Babylon. The Persian kingdom comes and takes over the Babylonian kingdom. And so God's people are stuck over in this place way east and north of where they're ever meant to be. And they're trying to make life as servants and second-class citizens and all of that. And during the time they're with Persia, one of the Persian kings actually sends back some of God's people, lets them go back to Jerusalem, but a lion's share of them are still there, just trying to get by. And it's during this time that the story of Esther takes place. Now, the most powerful king of that day was a king named Xerxes, spelled with an X, okay? So it's Xerxes, all right? And so Xerxes is the most powerful king on the planet. And Xerxes not only was a very powerful king, but Xerxes liked to party. In fact, the scripture says that he actually threw one party that lasted like half a year. And that's kind of where this story gets started. And let me read it to you there. And it says this. So he's in the middle of this party. He says, on the seventh day of the feast, when King Xerxes was in high spirits because of the wine, he told the seven eunuchs who attended him to bring Queen Vashti to him with the royal crown on her head. He wanted the nobles and the other men to gaze on her beauty, for she was a very beautiful woman. But when they conveyed the king's order to Queen Vashti, she refused to come. This made the king furious, and he burned with anger. All right, so we lose a little bit in translation here and a little bit in cultural reality here. So let me tell you what was going on with Vashti here and why she didn't show up. What is strongly implied here is that when the king said, go get Vashti, I want her to parade around in front of my nobles in her crown. He said, bring her in her crown. What he meant was, bring her in only her crown. That's what's going on here. And that is why Queen Vashti said, ain't gonna happen. She told the king, I am not going to do that. Does anyone want to give a hearty good for her tonight, right? Good for her. All right, in fact, let me just stop for a minute. Side note, I want to say something to the young ladies in the room. Listen carefully to me. This story is over 3,000 years old, but Vashti is schooling you today. Because I want to tell you something. I don't care what that boy promises. You keep your clothes on in any picture you're going to send him. Come on, church. You can amen better than that. All you people think the Bible doesn't talk to today, you just don't read it. And I can tell you right now, nothing good happens. Say that with me. Nothing good happens. Say it with me. Nothing good happens when we send naked pictures. So don't do it. Are we all good? And now back to our story. So the king, Xerxes, who has idiots for advisors, say, well, now what do I do? He's mad. Eventually comes to, what am I going to do? And this is what his advisors say. Whoa. You better deal hard with this, King Xerxes, because if you let her get away with this, the rest of us are in trouble because our wives will start thinking that they don't have to do what we tell them to do. So you need to deal with it. So the king says, you're right. He kicks Vashti to the curb. And so he goes on for a few years without a queen. But eventually King Xerxes says, you know, I can't be a king without a queen. Can't be a kingdom without a queen. And so he says, here's what I want you to do. Send out the servants. Bring me the most beautiful women you can find in the land. And let's refill. Let's restock my harem. So that's what they do. And it's at this point that we're introduced to the character of Esther. Now, Esther had already been through, by the time we meet her, Esther had already been through an extremely difficult life. As a young girl, her mom and her dad died. She was separated from them somehow. And so she was actually raised by her older cousin, a man named Mordecai. Now, as a good Jewish girl, when the word went out that the king was looking for young women, young virgins that would be added to his harem, this is the last thing she would have wanted to do. She would have been no way been interested in being lumped in with the local Persian girls who are being taken to the king. She wants no part of this. But look with me how the story goes. When the king's order and edict had been proclaimed, many girls were brought to the citadel of Susa and put under the care of Haggai. Esther also was taken to the king's palace and entrusted to Haggai, who had charge of the harem. So I want you to see there, they separate out when she's taken. They say Esther also was taken. That word taken there means seized or taken away. Can I tell you this? Sometimes, even when we are doing our very best to honor God, the very thing that we least want to happen in our life happens. It just does. Things that can bring fear towards us, scary things that we wish wouldn't happen, happen. I mean, I can imagine that Mordecai gave her every instruction he could. You know, keep dirt on your face. Don't brush your hair today. Keep yourself hidden away. But her beauty was discovered. And even though we are commanded not to be overcome with fear, hear me, church, we will face fearful situations. God does not keep us from situations that can sometimes make the heart race. God will allow sometimes for the waves to get choppy. But I want you to think about it this way. If you think of the fearful situation, whatever that difficulty is, whatever that trouble is, whatever that concern is, if you think of that like choppy water, and that's out there, the key to make it in your boat across choppy water is to not let what's outside the boat get inside of the boat. See, there might be fear out there, but it doesn't mean you have to let fear rule in here. So, we find out that Esther is taken there and she's a part of that harem, and then sure enough, whether it was from her beauty or her charm, ultimately, it's by God's design, she actually becomes queen. So the ultimate protagonist in the story, this wonderful girl, now becomes queen. Now, any good story needs a good bad guy. And this story's got one. His name is Haman. Haman's Persian born. He's a local boy, and he rises his way up through the ranks till he's at the place of what we'll call prime minister. And this local boy hates the Jews. He hates these outsiders that have been brought in and allowed to be a regular part of the culture. And he hates one Jew in particular. He hates Mordecai. Remember him? The older cousin who raised Esther, he hates Mordecai because when Haman walks through the streets, Haman has so much power, and Haman is such a violent guy that everybody bows when they see Haman coming in fear. But Mordecai won't bow because Mordecai says, you know what? I bow only to the king of the universe, and Haman, you ain't him. So I won't bow. Haman hates Mordecai. And so Haman finally says, I got to do something about this. I mean, he's the king's right-hand man, so he goes to the king. And he says to the king, you know what? There are these Jews amongst us, and you can't trust them because they're not the locals. You can't trust them, and someday they're going to rise up against you. And what we really ought to do, you know what you ought to do, king? You ought to make a ruling that there's going to be a day out there in the future that's going to be Kill a Jew Day. And we'll just give people a chance to get ready for it, and we'll just say, we'll kill as many of them as we can, and we'll kill them off. And Haman has enough influence on Xerxes that Xerxes agrees to us, and he signs this law. Not only a law that says that this day is going to come when all these Jewish people can get killed, but a law also, the law is laid out that says, and this day is in the distant future. It was laid out to be within about a year. Which brings us to another stopping point on fear that we need to talk about for a minute today, which is this. Sometimes the greatest fears that rise up and grab us are fears about the future. Pull away from this specific story for just a minute, because I want to tell you, the enemy will try to use time against you, and he will get your thinking and your imagination going to where something out there, you become so afraid of it that it's constantly, that day's coming, and this bad thing is going to happen, and I don't know what I'm going to do about it. And what happens is, when there are things that make us nervous or uncertain that are in our future, we magnify them in our present. And I want you to know something. Many times, all of the things that we feared would happen out there in the future never even come to pass. That's why, as one wise man once said, fear is a waste of a good imagination. And so what happens is we take small things, real and challenging but small, and we make them big. And we take big things and we make them gigantic. And we take gigantic things and we say, this is the end for me. So what do you do when you face fear? Esther's facing now a fearful situation, but she doesn't even know it yet, because let me take you back to the story. So what happens is, now the king makes this law, but the king doesn't even know that he's sentencing his own queen to death, because the king somehow wasn't even aware that Esther was Jewish. You can see the king and queen must really spend a lot of quality time talking together, right? I bet he really doesn't know what to buy her for Christmas. I mean, he doesn't even know that Esther is Jewish. And the flip side of this that's so interesting is, so the king doesn't know that he has written a decree that's sentencing his own queen to death. And on the flip side, the queen doesn't even know that there's a decree that's been written that's putting her in jeopardy. Because she is in the palace. She's kind of tucked away from all this. She doesn't even know this is happening. In fact, the only way she finds out is that she has servants who, you know, they leave the palace and they go out and they're in the streets with the everyday people. And one day her servants see Mordecai. He's got sackcloth on. It's like rough clothing. His clothing is torn. He's got ashes on his head, because when the king made this ruling, they went ahead and announced it all out there in the public. So everybody out there knew about it. The queen, she's in the casual culture. She hasn't even heard. But Mordecai knows, and so Mordecai is mourning. And so the servants go back to Esther and say, hey, you know what? We bumped into your cousin Mordecai. Strangest thing. Guy's got ashes on his head. Strangest thing. His clothes are torn. He's weeping. He won't even raise his head. And so she says, okay, take a fresh set of clothes with him and ask him what's going on. So they go back out with this fresh set of clothes and say, hey, Mordecai, what's going on? And so Mordecai explains to this servant, his name is Hathach, what's going on. And then if you look here on the screen, you'll see what happens. So Mordecai then explained it to him, and then he also gave him a copy of the text of the edict for their annihilation, which had been published in Susa, to show to Esther and explain it to her. And he told him to urge her to go into the king's presence to beg for mercy and plead with him for her people. All right, look here. This is an important twist in the story. So here's what happens. Mordecai says, you didn't know about this because you're up in that nice, high and exalted place. And he's not angry that she is, but you're there and you didn't know about this. But here's what you need to know. This is the reality of what's going on. And then don't miss it. And this is what he says. So Esther, what are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it? You know what? Esther's life probably got to the place where it was clipping along pretty good. She's the queen. She has anything she wants. She has beauty treatments. She has food. She has servants to do the dishes. Anybody getting a little jealous of Esther yet? I mean, she's got it good now. Esther's got it good. And sometimes in life, I think we believe that somehow fear is just this compartmentalized thing. It's like, well, if I can get past this situation, then I'll never have to be afraid again. But here's the reality, folks. You never outgrow trouble in life. There's always going to be something. There's always something coming down the path. With every new level, there's a new devil. It's just the way that it is. And this is why overcoming fear, listen, don't miss this. Overcoming fear is an ongoing lesson. It's not like you can just say, well, I learned how to never be afraid over there. No, you continually learn what it means to trust God in this new place where you're at in life, with this new reality, with this new challenge, in this new blessing. It's not that I'll never have something that'll generate the possibility for fear again. It's just that I'm learning in an ongoing way to trust God. So Esther gets this word, and Mordecai says, what are you going to do, Esther? And so Esther sends back word that says, we got a little problem here. Look at what it says. Hathach went back and reported to Esther what Mordecai had said. Then she instructed him to say to Mordecai, this is like, you know, hey, take this note. You get the note, take that note. He says, tell him this. All the king's official and the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king has but one law, that he be put to death. The only exception to this is for the king to extend the gold scepter to him and spare his life. Look what she says. But 30 days have passed since I was called to go to the king. This is what she says to him. Mordecai, if I do this, I'm putting my life at risk. There's a good chance if I go and do what you're asking me to do that this is not going to come out well for me. Look, if I go into the court and the king isn't happy with me, and Mordecai, in case you forgot, this king doesn't have a good track record with queens who think on their own. It's like, you know, look up Vashti in dictionary. And so Mordecai then responds back. So he's jotting the note back. He writes, when Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back this answer. Do not think that because you're in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to royal position for such a time as this. Folks, when you're telling a story, this is where you get to the apex. You get to this moment, decision time. Mordecai looks at her and says, listen, Esther, if you let fear stop you from doing what you need to do, if you do nothing, you're as good as dead anyhow. Your only choice in this fearful situation is to face it and honor God in the middle of it. That's the only option you have. Sometimes, friends, we think that the safest thing we could do when we're afraid is recoil. It's hide. It's don't deal with it. It's maybe try to wait it out and maybe it will go away. And we think somehow cowering from fear conquers fear. It doesn't. Only facing fear conquers fear. Only getting to a place where we say, you know what? Fear is not of God. Love is from God. And we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but we are those who step forward and do what God has called us to do. So amidst that fear that I'm facing in my life, I'm going to go for it. Does it sound risky? You bet it does. You know what it's like? It's like working on a 10th floor of a great big high-rise building, and one day a massive fire breaks out and the building is burning down. And you go to the edge of your work suite, and when you open the door, the fire is just massive, and there's no way for you to escape that way, and all your exit routes are cut off. Your heart is beating with fear, and you back up, and you're like, what am I going to do? And the fire starts coming across the office, and the only thing you can do is pull open that great big window, and you step out on that ledge. And you're standing there, and you're looking back in the window at this fire, and you're looking out, and and suddenly you hear someone say, jump! And you say, what kind of cruel... Until you look more carefully and you realize it's actually four firemen. And it's hard to tell because looking down 10 stories, they look kind of tiny. And you look down, and it kind of looks like between the four of them, they're holding a net that you really wish was a lot bigger than it looks from here. And they're saying, come on, jump, jump. And you turn around and you're looking at the fire coming at you. You're like, it doesn't look good. And you're looking at that tiny little net, you're thinking, that doesn't look either. And this is what you're thinking. You're thinking, I want a third option. But if you just remain, you die. So what do? You take the proverbial leap of faith, don't you? You jump. Man, that looks small. But you jump. Because you're jumping towards the arms of the one you must trust. And this is how it is. And we become a people who say, you know what? If I just let fear paralyze me, it just steals my life. And it's time to jump. Some of you have been paralyzed and a long time ago should have jumped out of that toxic dating relationship. Some of you a long time ago should have just gone to school and said, I don't know if I can do it, but I'm going to give it a try. Some of you a long time ago should have started that company. Some of you a long time ago should have had that hard conversation that scared you to death with that person to restore that relationship, but you were so afraid to do it. Some of you long ago should have shared that testimony with that guy at work, but you keep swallowing it because you're just afraid. Some of you a long time ago should have gotten involved with the ministries that are going on around here. Some of you a long time ago should have owned up to some of the things you did in the past, but you just keep running from them and you keep hiding and they keep chasing you down. And at some point, you've got to face the fear that paralyzes you and say, what honors God I will do. Some of you need to go home and look at your husband and say, look, this marriage has been rough. We got to step into counseling and honor God. Make this work. And the unknown of what it would be like to actually be in love again actually feels a little scary to you because it's been so long since you felt it. But you say, you know what? God hates divorce and we should too. It scares you to even think about doing it, but you step into what it takes to honor God with these circumstances in our lives. And Esther decides, I have to face my fear. Too much is on the line. And what if Mordecai is right? What if God has aligned all this and set all of this up? And this hasn't happened to me by chance. And I know I'm afraid. But what if I'm going to be used by God once I face that fear? How did Mordecai say it? Maybe I'm here for such a time as this. And so she responds. And here it is, textbook. This is how we're going to wrap up the sermon today. Textbook how you face your fears. Look what she says. Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. Go gather yourselves together with all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maids will fast as you do. And when this is done, I will go to the king, even though it's against the law. And if I perish, I perish. So Mordecai went away and carried out all of Esther's instructions. And on the third day, Esther put on her royal robes and stood in the inner court of the palace in front of the king's hall. Okay, teach us, Esther. I'm scared. What do I do? I'm going to show you what she showed us. Are you ready? Here's what you're doing. You're going to do three things. Pray it. Say it. Do it. Come on, say it with me. Pray it, say it, do it. One more time. Pray it, say it, do it. I just gave you enough time for some of you to get a pen out because some of you are like, I got a feeling Pastor Todd is stumbling by accidental into something genius. I need to write this down. He must have gotten it from someone smarter than him. You bet I did. Pray it, say it, do it. You start with prayer. You pray it. First thing she said is, all right, guys, we're going to fast and we're going to pray. You know, some of you, the first step to you being freed from fear is just getting knees before God and say, you know what, God, I'm scared to death right now. God, this is stealing life from me, and this is not what you intended. So make me brave. Help me do what's right. Pray it. God, you've got to help me. Whatever part is your part in doing it, it would be great right now for you just to start doing it so I could see it. But either way, I'm trusting you. You know, extra biblical sources from that day have a prayer that they credit to Esther. I don't know if this literally is the prayer she prayed, but it's a beautiful thing. As you know, some of the other writings of the day says, this is what Esther prayed. Maybe they're just surmising from her inner chamber, but I love it. Let me show you. It says, Queen Esther, seized with mortal anguish. So look at me, because most of you today probably won't go home and say, I'm seized with mortal anguish. Okay, translate, scared to death. Queen Esther, scared to death, fled to the Lord for refuge, taking off her splendid garments. She put on garments of distress and mourning, and then she prayed to the Lord, the God of Israel, saying, My Lord, you alone are our king. Help me, who am alone and have no help but you, for I am taking my life in my hand. O God, whose power is over all, hear the voice of those in despair. Save us from the power of the wicked and deliver me from my fear. You all fast, she told them. I'm going to fast. You all pray. I'm going to pray, because if I'm going to be able to do something brave and face my fears, it's going to start because I'm going to pray it. Come on, say pray it with me. Pray it. We're going to pray it, then we're going to say it. All right, the second one is what? Say it. She says, she actually says, this is what I need to do. She's going to say it. In fact, look what she says. She actually says, if I perish, I perish. For all you real modern folks, that means if I die, I die. You know, people get caught up in fear with the words, what if? What if that happens? What if that, what if, and what if that leads, and what if that leads, and what if, it's a downward spiral. You know what Esther taught us? We don't talk about our future with what ifs. We actually should turn what if into if. It's a huge difference. In other words, what we say is, I'm not going to go, oh no, what if that happens? I can't handle it. What if that? We're just going to say, if that happens and that's what God's will, then we'll deal with it then. There's a huge difference. What if ties us up, but if simply says, I commend this and I commit this to God. What if steals your breath away? If lets us breathe again. And here's the difference. What if gives birth to what's called the second thought? If some of you received counseling before, perhaps you've heard of what the second thought is. The second thought is taking a circumstance that is in front of us that is naturally a fear-inducing circumstance. Remember we talked about the bears running at us? There are times when the heart's going to run. It's a scary circumstance. The what if, the second thought is taking the reality of what we're facing and saying, if that goes wrong, what if that leads to that? See, that's why it's called the second thought. I'll give you a few examples so you understand what I mean. And this is why we have to stop talking this way, what if, what if, what if. And we need to begin to say, well, if that happens, that happens, and this will be in God's hands. For example, You might be in a situation where your company is downsizing, and it's a very realistic possibility that you're going to lose your job. And you say, it's scary. You know, I lay in bed and I think about this stuff, and I'm trusting it to God. And so this is a scary situation. Okay, it's a realistic possibility that you're going to lose your job. But then if you say, okay, I'm going to lose my job, and what if when I lose my job, I can't get another job? And what if I can't get another job, I can't make my house payment, and what if all the way until you have yourself in complete bankruptcy? When the current situation is not that you're in bankruptcy, the current situation is that your job is in jeopardy. Did you track with me? You see, that's called the second thought. It's what if, what if, what if, what if. You see, instead we say, okay, God, if it's your will, I'll lose my job. And when I do, I'll be an unemployed servant of God looking for a job. That's all that I know so far. Second thought. Here's another one. This medical test might not come back well. Yeah, the doctor saw some things. There's a reason he gave that test. We're thinking there's a real possibility. It's this or that or the other. And so this test might not come back well. That is your current reality. But some of us begin the what if, the second thought. And the second thought goes from, well, what if the test comes back and it's the worst thing we feared? And what if when I get that worst thing, it turns into something even worse? What if this goes all the way? What if it's fully canceled? And we have ourselves dead and in the grave. And we do that in our minds. The second thought, the second thought, the second thought. And what in reality we should say is, if the tests come back bad, we'll trust God and we'll take whatever the next step is. There's a world of difference between those two. The one lets you breathe, the other steals your breath. The second thought of saying, I'm going into this meeting at work today and it's going to be contentious. It's not going to be an easy meeting. It's factual. You know it's not going to. But some of you go from this isn't going to be an easy meeting all the way to you've got yourself ostracized. You've got yourself fired. You've got yourself demoted. You've got yourself over in the corner and no one ever talks to you again. You got all this stuff going on. And all the reality is you're walking into a difficult meeting. And if this meeting plays out in a way that's not good, then not the other side of the meeting, I'll be a child of God living for Christ in the midst of an awkward and difficult situation right now at work. See, that's the if. If that's how it goes, that's how it goes. Today's going to be pretty rough. That might be reality. I'll be facing something that is difficult. But the second thought is, and I think tomorrow's going to be worse, and the day after that's going to be worse than that, and the day after that's going to be worse than that. Don't talk that way. Don't talk that way. Somebody say, hey, God's in charge. Esther took it all the way to the end and said, hey, if this goes all the way till I die, well, then so be it. If that's where it is, then that's where it is. But she said, I'm going to trust God and walk into that. Which leads us, by the way, to the third one, and it's this. It's not only pray it and say it, it's do it. It's do it. Say that with me. Do it. And so she did. She went to the king, took her life in her hands, went to the king that day. And you know, when she did, he saw her out there entering the court area, taking her life in her hands, and he extended his scepter to her. You see, not only did he not kill her, but he invited her in. And not only did he invite her in, she eventually got his ear to the point to where she told her story. And not only was she able to tell her story, but the bad guy was exposed. And not only was the bad guy exposed, but wait, you know what? I'm not telling you any more of the story. You can go home and read it today. Because you already have all of the story you need for what I need to preach. So, too bad. All I'm going to tell you is it's got an awesome ending, and you ought to go home and finish it. But here's what I want you to know. Not only did she not die, but God honored what she did and so completely turned the tables for the Jewish people that to this day, there is annually a celebration called Purim that celebrates what Esther did and what God did through her. All because she refused to be paralyzed by fear. You want to get unstuck today? What's the three steps? Come on, you know it without being on the screen. Pray it, say it, do it. One more time. Pray it, say it, do it. Here's the reality, folks. There is only one God-ordained response to fear that'll get you unstuck, and it is, I will not fear. Would you bow your heads together with me today as we close?